myself up. So we'll start with the usual questions. I mean, any first timers for me? First time you are first to meet, right? Few people. So you just introducing the tech for folks for other stuff. So it's a tech forum, which I know people meet once in a month. So it is primarily sponsored and supported by Thoughtworks. So Thoughtworks organizes NilaTech in every city that we have presence in. So, and this is Coimbatore edition of NilaTech. So in Coimbatore specifically, we meet every month, third Thursdays. So from evening 6 o'clock onwards. So it's a forum where, there will be sessions talks on topics in technology landscape. It could be about any tools, techniques, any approaches that you have worked, or anything that you have failed in doing something. It's a forum for us to share and learn from each other. So we have speakers from the city, sometimes even outside the city. It's a very forum for people to come and share. It's not just our workers speak, but we have a lot of people from anyone who is in our industry can come and speak. So if you find it useful, please spread the word, bring your friends as the next thing. If you have anything that you can improve, please talk to one of us, or just me, Rabla, or one of us here. With that, we'll get started with the first talk today. Raju is here, he's from NilaTech, he's going to talk something interesting. And after that, we have another talk by Apple on MacBook as well. So we'll get started with the first one.
Good evening, everyone. I think it's two. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yeah, okay. Pretty much right. Okay, so before we begin, I would like to give a small intro about NilaTech and the company. So I'm Raju K, I'm the co-founder of a tech startup called NilaTech Robotics. We are based out of ASC, here in Coimbatore. This company that we are running is founded, we started this company around 4.5 years back. Actively we started working on robotics just 4.5 years back. And we have two products, one is in the field already. And today's presentation is about how to use artificial intelligence in a practical manner. The reason why we started looking at artificial intelligence for robotics is that we found, I'm from a mechanical background, so I'm a mechanical engineer and my co-founder is also a mechanical engineer, and that will give you all the reasons why we are building robots. So the philosophy behind using artificial intelligence for robotics is that machines basically, it evolved the same speed as which the computer science industry has evolved. Right, machines are there for almost more than 200 years. The lathe was invented almost 200 years back, but it's still the same lathe. Not much of innovation went in there. Of course, we have CNC machines, computer numerical control machines, but it will be, comparatively, if you take the computers, the way they have evolved in the past 2-3 decades, machines did not evolve the same way. So given the 200 years of history and the learning, when I start a machine, let's take an example of a lathe. If I start running a lathe, even after 200 years of its evolution, it still cannot tell what metal it is working on, what is the dimension of the metal, what is the tool in which it is operating, what is the speed in which it has to operate. So that's why we employ a CNC operator, to program stuff like, I'm putting this metal, this grade metal, so you set your speed like this, take this tool, take this lubricant, and, all that stuff, right? So we found that as a very limited, so machines should evolve as well. And AI gives a lot of scope for the machines to evolve, right? So that is the, you know, background in which we started looking at AI. And this one is actually this was almost done 6 months back. We are trying to, you know, involve several different machine learning algorithms which we could use for, you know, robotics. And we found one of the approach in machine learning too fascinating, and it gave us very good results in the real world and physical application. So I thought, let us, you know, give this to others and see how this can be, you know, integrated into our fields, like other than machines, basically. Okay. And I took a puzzle as an example, you know, how to use this AI, both machine learning and artificial intelligence part, to make the session, you know, more fun, and you know, so that I can present the concepts in a very simple manner. I don't want to bore you with all theories and stuff like that. Don't expect anything theoretical from me, because I'm not a theoretical guy, I'm an application guy. So if you ask me about the background mathematical or probability details, I may not be able to answer that. But if you ask me about the application part of it, probably I might be able to tell you. So the puzzle that we are going to see today is a simple grid of 3x3 matrix. This game is called Puzzle Bunny. Okay. The concept of the game is that, you know, you have a field of carrots, okay, which are ready to harvest, but you have bunnies on the field which, you know, takes away your harvest, okay. So you need to get rid of the bunnies that are available on the field in the 3x3 matrix, okay. And the way the game works is that when you toggle a cell, okay, when you touch this particular cell, it will invert the cell which is being touched and the cell which is on the left, right, top and bottom. You get the concept, right? So you need to toggle in a sequence such that this matrix is you know, void of any bunnies. So then the game state is complete. That is the goal that you need to achieve. So this is a very, very simple concept. So here the logical rule is that there are two things. One is that, you know, the dimension of the problem statement, which is 3x3 matrix. And then this is the operating logic, right? And then we have the goal, right? Okay, so this is how we used to solve traditionally in computer science terms. We used to solve the puzzles, maybe Sudoku or any that sort of puzzle things are solved by using the traditional graph-based methods. You will have, you know, states, okay, the initial state will be given, and you apply all the possible operations from this state and construct the different states that are possible from this state. You know, you keep on, you know, constructing the graph indefinitely until you achieve, you know, the goal statement. And if there are multiple, you know, goals available, then you do a graph traversal, you know, find a minimal distance where you can go from one to other. Thereby you can, you know, get the steps to solve the puzzle. That's how, this is how the traditional solvers work. But the problem in this traditional approach is that, you know, this graph can go very complex, you know. It can get deeper such that, you know, you start getting Stack Overflow and heap problems, all that. Because in a mobile phone, so this is a mobile phone game, so mobile has a very limited capacity. And we used to, you know, we are developing games. I think I should have, you know, told this earlier, why games, robotics and games doesn't go too well together. So games are a stress buster strategy in our company, okay. 80% of your time you do your day-to-day business activity, and every other employee in the organization is given an opportunity of, you know, spending 20% of his time on things which is interesting to him or her. You know, they can explore whatever activity. It could be anything. It could be a product. It could be a concept. Anything that they can work on. So the thing that is close to my heart is developing games. So games is a perfect playing field to learn different algorithms, technologies, stuff. So that is the reason why we took games, and there are several games already available in the Play Store under our developer category. And when we develop it for mobile phones, we always develop it for the low grade device. You know, the 1 bit, the one sells for, you know, 2,000-2,500 bucks Android phone. It should, our game should run in that device. The performance will be measured only on that device, not on the devices which are higher grade. So these traditional servers cannot go in those mobile phones because they have very limited memory capacity. So that is the reason why we wanted to employ artificial intelligence, right? How many of you already have knowledge about artificial intelligence and how stuff works? Can I go into the basic building blocks of artificial intelligence? Only two. So let me just go through the basic building blocks of artificial intelligence. So there are several data structures that are available to build an artificial intelligence system. The one that I'm going to discuss about is going to make use of a construct called neural networks. Neural networks are a data structure which are built based on how a human brain works, you know, how it learns stuff and things like that. So in a nutshell, I'm not going to dive deeper in that area because that's a C in itself. Okay, the basic building block is that, you know, you will have three different layers: input layer, header layer, and output layer. And you can have as many input hidden layers to process, depending upon the complexity of the problem that you are trying to solve. You can increase the number of hidden layers, but you will have one input layer and one output layer. And the circuits that are indicated here are called the neurons. And it can be a fully connected neural network, or it can be, you know, sparsely connected. It depends on the problem statement that we are trying to solve. The one that we are going to use is fully connected neural network, and the input is typically, so if you take our game, what you see is as an input? The grid. Okay, 3x3 grid. So we have 9 cells, and let us put the zeros and ones for the state of bunnies. Okay, if it is 1, then it means there is a bunny. If it is 0, then it means a carrot. Okay, so we can numerically code it as zeros and ones and represent the state of the matrix. So we have 9 inputs. I have additional inputs when I actually implemented the algorithm, but I will explain it why we made that additional inputs when we see the Python section of it. And the output layer is the possible actions. Okay, so in this game, the possible actions are, you know, which cell I need to select next. So there are 9 possible actions, starting from 0. So array is indexed from 0. So let's say 0, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. So these are all the possible actions. But when you take a neural network, it won't say that, you know, you need to take this particular action. Okay, it will say that probably at an 80% confidence, we can select the cell number 8. That's how it will tell. So, for each of the possible operation, what is the confidence level? Okay, that's how the neural network will give you a feedback when you process the neural network. So, there are 9 possible operations which are available in the puzzle. It won't say you that, you know, you just go and click number 1. No, it wouldn't say that, but it will say that, you know, at 60% confidence, you can click cell number 1. Okay. So, in our case, we will have 9 different outputs which will signify, you know, what is the percentage possibility in which I can perform the operation. Right? Clear or? Okay. Right. So, then comes the Markov decision process. So, this entire thing is split in 2 different logical steps. Okay. The first part is machine learning. Okay. Machine learning is the part where you build the intelligence. Okay. You construct the neural network, train it, you know, and persist the trained state. We call it a brain. Okay. Just like a human brain. You persist the trained knowledge as a data structure. So, this first part is called machine learning, okay, that is done separately, and this is computationally very intensive operation, okay. The second part is actually using that built intelligence in an application. It can be a smartphone application or a computer executable which makes use of the trained intelligence. Supplies the input, performs the operation, and you know, gets the results. Okay, this is the second part is called as the execution part, which is artificial intelligence. Okay, the Markov decision process is the key training process which is involved in the machine learning state. Okay, when we train the neural network, okay, I think this is a very good time. I will switch to the code part so that you can make a correlation. So, as I told, so let us come to the first part, which is the machine learning part. Machine learning part where we need to build the neural network first, right? So, to build the neural network, I used PyTorch as a framework. So the network class which is defined here.
Raju, screen is not sharing. Probably you can disable the. Just keep it mirrored.
No. He's showing code. That's not coming. You are able to see it in the right feed, but not there. Not shared for you.
Oh.
Yes, it's in the machine box. Yeah, I think because we cancel, it should work. Right. So this is the Python machine learning module. So the first building block is the neural network, which is a very simple. I'm not going to explain line by line, but I will just give you the key areas wherein you know this intelligence is built. So you can see that the input size is the size of the matrix. How many inputs that I am going to give to the neural network, and what is the number of possible actions which are expected out of this neural network. So the first layer, as you can see, the MC1 will have the input size as you know the initial node, and then I start having hidden layers. This FC2, FC3 and FC4 are the hidden layers. The first hidden layer has 120 neurons, second hidden layer has 60, and third hidden layer has 30, and the final layer has 10, which is mapped to the possible number of actions. In a nutshell, you know, this architecture of the neural network, you have to experiment a little bit, you know. There is no hard and fast rule which says that, you know, these many inputs you need to have, you know, this kind of, not like that. It depends on the kind of complexity that we are trying to model, okay. If it is simple, then the number of neurons that you are going to, you know, the number of layers and the number of neurons that are going to be present is going to be less. But if it is a very complex system, then it is going to be a whole different game. So I went through almost, this was the fourth iteration, four different neural networks I tried, and this one was the one which was, you know. To start with, as a guideline, what you can do is, you can multiply the number of inputs by 10. That will give you the first hidden layer neurons. So I had 11 inputs as the input layer, so it should be like 110. I made it 120. Okay. Then I started reducing that neurons layer by layer, 120 to 60, 60 to 30, 30 to 10, and the number of actions are 9, so 10 need to be again converted as 9 as the number of possible actions. You can try actually, this is not, you know, something of a scientific way where I can, you know, give you rules to apply, you know, build an architecture. This is not like, you know, ER modeling or something like that. This you play it, see the result, and then you know remodel stuff. Right. Then and all the layers are linked. Relu is used as an activation function. So every neuron. So those who are new to this neural network stuff. You should know how a neural network learns when you train stuff, right? So at every neuron there is an activation function. Okay, so that there are several different activation functions available. You can choose based on the kind of problem statement that you are working on. For this particular stuff, I use the Relu. Generally, there are two functions, sigmoid and relu, which are most commonly used in machine learning function. Sigmoid is, to my experience, the kind of problems that I worked. Sigmoid is kind of very rough kind of thing. It doesn't model smoothly. Relu is much better, gives a much better, smoother representation of the trained model. So I use Relu as a activation function. So that's what is done in this part of the code, where for each of the layer I use the Relu as an activation function, and it's a fully connected neural network layer. Right. So this part where I represented by the class network, you can roughly map it to the gray material inside our head. Right, the brain. Okay, in terms of when it comes to for artificial intelligence, then comes memory. So memory is a part where you hold the actions that are taken previously, the outcome of it, okay, and this knowledge is preserved in our memory. So, you know, in our primary schools, we started learning alphabets, right? This memory is stored somewhere, right? So, for an artificial intelligence, when it is getting trained, it need to keep a you know, temporary memory, okay? So, this is a temporary memory location where, you know, keep the steps which are taken and the results that has happened. Right. So this memory is nothing but it's kind of an array list where it stores the different states and the results. Then comes the deep learning model. Okay. So this deep Q learning is the learning model where you start teaching the neural network. This will have the brain that you have already designed and the memory, and it will make use of the memory to store the outcomes and results, and it will start training the brain that you have already designed. So we'll hold on here, and then we will, you know, we'll let us come to this learning part. So until here it is clear, right? What is a neural network? You know, the purpose of it, right? Okay. So in the training process, we need to teach the neural network that for every action that it has taken, what is the result, and you start giving it a reward or penalty. Okay, and this is what is called exploration. Okay, this is not something like you teach on a daily basis. Okay, in a classroom teaching, you teach the student giving logical steps. Okay, if you need to do addition, then you know you take fingers and you start counting. So this kind of teaching is not something that we are going to do while we are trying Markov decision process. In this process, let the AI do random stuff. Okay, that is what is called as exploration. So here in our puzzle, the possible actions are just nine possible actions are available. We allow the artificial intelligence to take any random action, and after taking the random action, what is the result? If it has reached the goal, then we give it reward. If it doesn't reach the goal, then we give a penalty. We don't say it as penalty, but we still say it as a reward, but the reward will be minus. A minus reward is nothing but as it's a penalty, right? So we take this case of, you know, this exploration where agent is nothing but the artificial intelligence which is trying to solve the puzzle. State is the current state of the matrix, and the action is the action that is going to be taken. And you know, every possible action, so there are, you know, this is the end goal that we need to reach, and this is a part which we are not supposed to reach. Okay, so in the space of exploration, you know, this agent will randomly visit each cell. Okay, if it reaches here, I will give a heavy penalty. If it reaches here, I will give a hefty penalty, sorry, hefty reward. So that the artificial intelligence will automatically adjust its weightage for the action, for the given state of the matrix, the action taken, and it will associate the reward. Okay, it is in state X and I have taken action 0, for which the reward is 10. So which is a fruitful action. If it is a positive reward, it's a fruitful result. If it's a negative reward, that's an action which I am not supposed to take. Right? Simple? Okay.
One question.
Yes.
So it takes multiple steps to reach that.
Yes. Yes.
Some of those steps might have been correct. Some of with the end goal, like you say, the same.
Yeah, there are multiple paths leading to that. You can decide your reward points. Okay. I can go this way, or I can go around way. You can choose your reward policy that if you reach the point within 3 steps, then the reward is 10. If you reach, you know, in 10 steps, then the reward is only 5. You refine the rewards. We will see that, you know, it is there in the training part. So, if this part is clear. Right. So in the deep to learning part, so what we do is, okay, so in the, this is the learning part where the model starts learning stuff. There is a statement called gamma, which I need to explain to you. Gamma is a thing which is missing, you know, in this slide actually. The exploration part, okay. Initially, when the AI starts learning, it will be very random, okay, and it will get lot of negative rewards. But as the time progresses, okay, when it starts learning, it will, from minus 2, it will go to positive score. Okay, it has already started learning. But in the exploration space, we will give an allowance for the agent, even after learning, do some random exploration. Okay, what if I go this way, there is a much better reward than this. Okay, so that is called gamma. Okay, in our case, we have given the gamma as 90%, which means that 90% of the time you do as you learn, but 10% of the time explore. Right? So, which will actually find ways in which the human operator cannot learn. So, this is what happened in AlphaGo. You might have seen AlphaGo, which was built by Google, built an artificial intelligence, and the AlphaGo artificial intelligence actually beaten the professional world champion. And it has played steps which the world champion was never given aware of. So those kind of, you know, steps are explored and learned by AI in the exploration space. Okay. Right. So the way it learns is that it takes from the memory 100 frames. Okay. We have a pool of memory which holds the previous states, actions taken and the reward. Okay, it will accumulate all that in a space, and in a learn cycle, it will take 100 random samples from this memory and it will re-optimize the entire brain. That's how it learns. Okay. And there is a score associated after each learning. What is the score? That is the learning score. So this is the machine learning part of it. And I'll show you one more. The actual MVP where it is applied. Right. The key thing that you need to note here in this is okay, so the brain will stop.
Difficulties in scrolling.
Right. Okay, so this is the brain. Brain is nothing but the previous class that I built for coding the entire neural network and the learning model. So here I pass, you know, this is the input. I'm going to pass 11 inputs. Okay. The main cells of the primitive matrix, and I supply two additional inputs which we will see in the consequent steps. And there are 9 possible operations, and this is gamma. Okay, 90% you do as per learning, and 10% you will explore and tell me. Okay, then this action is nothing but the number of possible actions. Which is taken on the cell. And this goal array, there is a variable called goal, and I have 1 to 9 different goals. This is actually a reward scheme model. Okay, the end goal is finally getting rid of all the buddies, okay, which are represented by 1. So at the end of the game, the matrix should be all zeros. Okay, but that was not enough because the AI was not hitting the goal in the exploration phase, and it was going all negative learning for a longer period of time. Okay, so then I just revised the strategy that if you are close to the goal, 1 step before the goal, then I give you a reward. So that way, you know, if the end goal is, you know, the reward is 100. But if you are 1 step before the end goal, I give you a reward of 10, positive reward. Then the AI will know, at least try to reach that goal. Right? So this is a reward strategy. This might differ from, you know, one problem statement to other. When your AI is not learning, or if it is not hitting the goal, then you need to revise your reward strategy. Okay, bring AA to your, you know, drag AA to follow the path in which it need to take by giving positive rewards on the way. Okay, so that's what is represented here. These are all the, you know, 1 step before the goal. Okay. Please raise your hand if you have any doubt. Okay. Okay. Then, okay, here comes the learning part where I update the brain. At the each cycle, each learning cycle, I update the brain with the last reward. And what is the matrix, level matrix? And this is the additional information that I supply. Step. The number of steps that are elapsed from the beginning. Okay, because I need to optimize the number of steps. You know, the AI should not take 1,000 steps to solve the 3x3 matrix, right? It has to solve at the most 5 or 10 steps, it has to solve the problem. So I supply the steps as an input as well. And there is a Boolean flag which will say that whether it has already reached the goal point, I mean previous to the goal point, okay, where we give a positive reward. So when you are 1 step before the goal, okay, the next possible step should be the goal, right? At this point, we should not explore, right? We need to stop that. So to give that indication, I just supply a Boolean fact saying, hey, see, you have already found, you are already near to the solution, don't explore. Okay, so I need to supply this flag along with the input so that it can learn. So here is the logical reward statements where I, the brain gives the next possible action, I perform the target operation on the matrix, where it will say that the state of the matrix will change. And after toggling operation, whether the level is equal to the goal. Goal is nothing but all zeros. If it is equal to the goal, then the level is success, right? So then I give the rewards, right? You know, if it has solved within 5 states, then the last reward is 12. I mean, then the reward is 20. If it is, you know, 10 steps, then it is done. If it has taken more than 10 steps, then the reward is done. So here what we are enforcing is that, you know, to teach the AI that solve the problem within minimum number of steps. So I think this answers your question, right? So this part is something that you need to explore, and this will actually change from problem to problem. Depends on, you know, how you want to train. Right. So after each level is finished, then I reset the matrix where I randomly set the level matrix, you know, randomly set bunnies, and then supply that state as an input, you know, because the AI need to be able to solve a given matrix with bunnies at any position, right? So I need to supply different models, different positions, take different actions and try to solve the problem. So that's what is done here. Okay, then comes the negative, penalty part. If you don't give penalty part, the AI will not, you know, learn. So here what I try to do here is that, you know, there is a dictionary I kept, okay, from the start state. Okay, after performing operations, for each state, the state is saved in the dictionary. Okay, so in a given puzzle, I should not have the same state again and again. That will be redundant and it will increase the number of steps. So, any action that gives a previous state as a result is not appreciated, right? So I give a negative penalty.
Is it previous state? What do you mean by
that? Previous state is, say, let me take example. Let me take this state. This is the initial state. Okay. If you press the first cell, the state will be like this. Okay. If you again press the first cell, it will go back to this thing, which is not intended, right? So this will actually go back to the previous stage, which is not intended. So this action is a penalty. Okay, so that's what. Is given here. And then okay, after every 1000 learning cycle, I just save the brain. The trained brain is still saved as a physical data frame. So that, you know, even if the training breaks for some reason, I can load the trained brain from the previous state and start learning from that model. So this one, I just start running it to show you, you know, how AI explores So in this window, whatever you are seeing here, right? So now AI is actually exploring. So this number is the number of steps taken. Close to solution is the step which is prior to the goal. Okay. Level success is the success level. So it has taken 1000 steps to solve that puzzle. So this cycle will go on and on, right? So the model that I built, I have actually trained this model for 3 days. To come to an optimal trained brain, which takes just 4 or 5 steps to solve the puzzle. You can just keep on running this. The exploration phase, it explores, exhausts all the possibilities, and it tries to build the knowledge in the brain. Okay, so I will stop this here, and I will show you the learning graph. So for this 3x3 matrix, this was the learning curve. So these were the number of iterations. After 20,000 iterations, after 40,000, 60,000, 80,000, and 1 lakh. So that this is how, this is the score actually, the reward. If this goes, see, initially it will go into negative. The reward goes into negative because this is in the exploration phase. Tries to find out, and when it says within 15,000 cycles, it started learning and it tries to maximize the rewards. And I think this will, after this, this will just go as a straight line. So, this is the point we cut off the training and take the model for the next operation. So far, it's clear. I think it's too much to crunch at one go, but just keep this, key terminologies like Markov decision process and the neural network, its design, all this. Take these keywords, do your own experimentations. So this actually doesn't take much time to learn actually. If you take the Python code, the machine learning model is hardly 150 lines. Okay, and the PyTorch is very good at that, taking care of all the related stuff within just one single line of code. Okay, you need not write extensive code to make use of AI. Okay, right. Then we come to the second part. So this was the training model. Right, so I just try to execute it. This is an Android application. I use the trained model. It's too slow. Right. Okay, so this is the puzzle. So when I click on one particular cell, you can just see that it toggles. Okay, so you can go around this. So here in the press of start button, I implemented made use of the trained model, to take this as a state matrix and start solving it. So the yellow indication is the hint from artificial intelligence. Okay, I just do as artificial intelligence does, and let me see where it takes. So now logically I'm just two steps away. Let me see. So it is done. Right. Now I'll just give you a little more information about the models. So this is the neural network model. I mean, the physically saved file. Okay, this is how it looks in a data structure. Okay, you need not go into the details of this, but I will just show you a much simpler version of this. This might be confusing. Yeah. Right. So this ONNX is an open neural network exchange format, right? So these PyTorch models cannot be directly used with smartphone apps. But a model that you saved is in a PyTorch model. You need to convert that PyTorch trained brain to an a smartphone understandable format. So in case of Android, it is TensorFlow. You need to convert the PyTorch model into TensorFlow model. So I used the ONNX as an exchange format between these two. So here you can see this is the input. It's an array of 11 inputs and the output is 9. Okay. So since there are 9 outputs, how do I know which action to take? I just apply a softmax function and take whichever node has a highest probability. That is the action to take. So that is what the Android code does. So that summarizes all. So if you have any questions, I can take it. Is it, do you find useful? Because I was more interested in this because you can, with the use of this MDP and neural network, you can model any logical problem. Any logical problem, and you need not tell the neural network the logic. It will learn the logic on its own. You just need to tell what is your end target. What is that you are looking out of this target? And it's just a matter of time. It will explore on its own. If you have a good computing capacity, depending upon the problem statement, you'll be able to build the AI within no time. But this one actually took me about 2 weeks time roughly. 1 week to train the model and 1 week to finding ways to convert this PyTorch model into TensorFlow and to use it in an Android app. But that's an R&D phase, but if you ask me today, it will be just 2 or 3 days in which, and most of the 2 or 3 days will be on training the model. If you have a good computing capacity, it can be done within hours.
What is the real-time use cases?
I will tell you an example from my own experience. Okay, so this puzzle I took it to demonstrate and to make people understand. The real-world use case is that I took the case of robotics. So we make robots, industrial robots. And we found a lot of shortfalls in CNC machines and the robots that are available today. We wanted to remove all the human components which are involved in today's robotics and CNC. CNC needs a programmer to code, to tell the machine that, I'm going to feed you sheet metal which is 100 mm thick of this grade. You set your spindle speed, you set this tool, and set your origin here, all this. You need to instruct the machine. But we wanted to take all these variables away. Okay. The machine needs to know when I feed something into the machine should automatically tell me that, hey, this looks like oil steel, which is approximately 100 mm thick, and I recommend these tools. And it would be appropriate to set the spindle speed to 500 rpm, and I would use this kind of lubricant. This is the overall setup. We do not alter anything. So a machine need to be that intelligent going forward. We have, so this is the ideal scenario which we envisage to provide to the end market, and we have successfully solved 3 or 4 of this type. Our artificial intelligence is already able to tell that what is the kind of material that I am feeding in to my machine, and what is the shape of this material that I am feeding in. Is it irregular or regular? If it is regular, what shape is it in? Is it rectangle, triangle, you know, circle? So that kind of stuff. So don't take it to the extreme end. When I say that artificial intelligence in robotics, people misunderstand that, you know, they think we are producing humanoids, full-blown replacement to humans. No, we are not trying to solve that problem, and that is not something that a startup can do. We have very limited resources. So we technically call this AI a bite-sized AI. What I mean by bite-sized AI is that it is able to solve one part of the problem, like, you know, determining the metal which is being fed to the machine. It's a very small problem to solve, but it still solves it, you know, because a layman, anybody who can, you know, feed the machine can operate the machine. You need not have a technical man to, you know, handle the machine. Yes. So the example that I gave is from my domain. You need to see what are that opportunities in your domain. In what are the domain that you are operating? I think you can find there are lots of opportunities. Lot of you just need to target this bite-sized problems. Just don't try to, you know, bring artificial intelligence to solve a problem which is huge enough for a human to solve. No. Take that smaller chunk of problems. Another example that we have solved recently is that if you throw in a bin of bolts and nuts, okay, it will tell, the artificial intelligence will tell by looking at the bin, what is the size of that bolt, M4, M5, M6, and at what angle it is rotated. Right, so all these things it will decide on its own, and it will, you know, so that the robot can, you know, pick it up and, you know, do the perform the operation. For this, now you need a programmer. And these kind of scenarios, you know, robots used in a pre-cooked environment. You need to, if a robot need to handle stuff, it need to be sorted. There are trays for it. You know, you need to sort the objects in the tray and feed it to the robot. Then the robot will take it and put it. You know, this is not something, you know, which is very pleasing in a industrial atmosphere. Robots need to reduce work. It should not induce new work because they bought the robot. Okay, these are practical difficulties. They wanted to eliminate a labor, so they brought a robot. But the robot needed its input to be pre-sorted, so they employed the same person to do that. The purpose is beta, right? What is the purpose of, and the robots doesn't come very cheap. Very, the entry level robot itself, they cost in lakhs. So
probably put that the learning curve for the robots could be less by this.
What do you mean by
the learning curve? Because what happens is robots don't have mind of its own.
Yes, right? That's what we are
trying. Learning curve is the part that we are missing.
No, robots don't learn. Robots are programmed. So current robots, they are all programmed. They don't have intelligence of their own. They have senses. You know, there are computer vision modules which are available to, you know, scan the conveyor and tell whether the object is available on the conveyor or not. So that kind of, you know, crude computer vision is available nowadays. But the computer vision is not able to tell what is available on the conveyor. Is it a nut or bolt? what is the orientation in which it is, you know, located on the conveyor belt, so that I can move and pick it. So it's not 100% automated. You still need to do 20% of the work for the robot, and the robot does the 80%. Any other questions? And the interesting thing here is that it can be very easily built. Just 100 lines of code, and it gives a very beautiful, you know, problem solved. And just initially, it might take you some time to, you know, get hold of this technical stuff, like, you know, the neural network architecture and taking one particular model into smart product. This might take some time for you to, you know, get used to. But once you are into it, you can solve numerous problems. Numerous. And you can get rid of all algorithms. What AI takes away is that you need not write complex algorithms. And the neural network itself, they are very efficient. You know, the model that I built, it is hardly 10 kb in size. The brain is 10 kb in size, and it doesn't take anything in the memory to execute. So a total of around 1000 neurons are there. So 1000 neurons is like, you know, 14,000 float variables in the memory. That's all it takes. It doesn't take any complex structure or memory. It's very fast in execution. Once you build the memory and start supplying the inputs, it is like the very next nanosecond you have the result. But an algorithm has an algorithmic complexity, you know, the number of for loops and while loops, you know, crunches the execution time, the CPU time, GPU time, all that. One important thing I forgot to tell you, the reason why I chose PyTorch is that PyTorch makes use of GPUs when it does the machine learning. So it is faster when you do the machine learning execution. The other frameworks, mostly they are based on CPU. So it takes a much longer time for one more reason to use PyTorch. Yeah.
So have you tried using other forms of neural networks like
RNN or streams? I used the CNN. Convolutional neural networks based on image processing, taking the camera input and supplying it to the neural network to build the artificial intelligence. Haven't tried RNN. It depends on the, you know, the kind of work. I think RNN is very good at linguistic processing.